Welcome back to TalkNorth.com. Thank you for listening. If you can, please download before you listen. It helps our business. I'd also like to thank our producer, Brandon Morton, and let you know if you'd like to sponsor this program or any of the programs on the network, you can reach me at jsouhan47@gmail.com. I know you're going to be thrilled by this. We just had a question submitted by your best friend, Russo Slacks. I just wanted to start the night off on the right note.
You should start coming to these podcasts.
You've missed him. He's, you know, for all the grief he's given you, for all the Photoshops, for all the fame he's gathered, he's been to one live show.
I know. It's crazy.
One. And it was in St. Paul, which is like far less convenient than this show or the other shows we were doing.
Where does he live again?
I think it's West Suburbs.
What's his address?
I will find out and we will broadcast that.
Yeah.
I think it's only fair. I mean, he stalks you. People should be able to stalk
exactly.
him as well. He's Michael Russo.
If I knew how to Photoshop, I'd start Photoshopping him.
I don't think you're going to pick up that skill anytime soon. I really don't. He's Michael Russo. This is the Russo-Souhan Show. This is our hockey show on TalkNorth.com. Thank you to everybody who came out tonight to Tin Shed in Savage. Tin Shed I'm always so bad with this. TinShedMN.com is the website. Tin Shed Tavern and Pizza is the actual name of the restaurant. We do a couple shows here a month. We appreciate everybody who shows up. It is weird to do shows here, though, and not have Vicky and Clyde here.
Yeah, I know. They're right now stuffing Kirill Kaprasov into their trunk or something.
Does he fit in the overhead storage?
Sure, yeah, I think he does. I've never seen him in person, but... not the biggest guy.
How's he? What's the deal with him these days?
Just a hat trick, leading the KHL, yeah. Scoring, no big deal. We'll see him one day.
When? When are we going to see him?
Hopefully next year.
And so, what has to happen to make that happen?
They need to sign him as of after April 30th. He needs to hopefully forego any other contract extension offers from his KHL team. And the hope is that he'll be here next year. I can't believe we're talking about Kaprasov. I thought that was a topic that we don't discuss.
It is. I lured you in. Yeah. I lured you in. The show's like a minute old, and I've already gotten you talking in depth about Russo Slacks and Kaprasov.
Yeah.
So what do you do during the summer?
Usually, it's like 10 p.m. at night. I'll get texts from my mother, like when's Fiala coming, and what's Kaprasov doing? Just like random wild questions late at night.
What I love is anytime I needle you on social media, I get a response from your mother defending you.
Yeah.
She's very sensitive.
What was the latest one? I saw that today.
God,
it was yesterday, about Fran.
You for something. What was it about?
It was about Fran, the elevator
operator.
That was
right. You said something nice about Fran, about how much you love Fran. I said, she's not really a big fan of yours. And if Barbara's like, yes, she is. Don't pick on my son.
Yeah.
I mean, it's pretty amazing, given the way you treat her, that she still defends you.
That's probably a good point.
Have I made you feel awkward enough? What else can we talk about you don't want to talk about?
Nothing. I'm trying to pay attention to the Wild game. They play in Winnipeg tonight.
And why didn't you travel to Winnipeg? I'm glad you're here, but why aren't you there?
We have two Winnipeg writers up there to spend $1,200 to go up there to cover
a preseason game.
Steven Falkowski or whatever his name is. Yeah. Just didn't seem like the smart fiscal decision. I'll cover the two road preseason games next week in Denver and Dallas. Sandwiched, by the way, the Vail trip is in between. The Wild are going to Vail for 3 days of team bonding. They get there Sunday night after the game in Denver, then go Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Have a total bonding day on Monday with some fun activities set up by the Wild, and then Tuesday and Wednesday practice there and fly to Dallas for an exhibition game. So we're going to have mass cuts here in the next couple days. It's going to be interesting to see what they do. My guess is they bring about 28 guys to Vail.
Do these team bonding exercises ever yield something tangible, or is it just you feel like everybody feels like they need to do them these days?
Yeah, I mean, look, the Wild start 13 of their 15 games on the road. In Bruce's mind, he really just wants this team to figure out a way to come together as a team. I think with a new GM, some new players, some guys that are playing their first full years with the organization, it's a good decision to have. Plus, you get some high-altitude training up there. Only one team wins a cup every year, and I'm sure many teams do team bonding exercises, but this is what the Wild have done. I've done it before with the Florida Panthers, and it didn't exactly go well for them. So,
well, one of the first things I did when I got to Minnesota is, do you remember the Pecos River story?
No.
The Minnesota Vikings, it's like the players hated the front office hated the players. You know, there was an incredibly divisive yet successful organization. And so they decided to go to Pecos River. It was this retreat, team bonding retreat. They were like, might have been the first professional sports team in America to go on one of these things. Mm-hmm. So they packed the whole entire team up, go down to New Mexico, hold this bonding exercise. And that was in the summer of 1990. And by the end of 1991, Jerry Burns had bailed out. They went 6-10, then 8-8. Mike Lynn got fired, and they blew up the organization and started over.
So yeah. I don't think that'll happen this time with this team, but the thing with these trips is it's just a good way to get away. I think in training camp it gets monotonous when you're at your home every single day. It gets the guys together, especially when you're home too. They all have young families. They want to, the second the practice is over, the second they go down in the locker room, the second they get done working out, they want to get home. So this is just kind of a way of Bruce kind of getting them all together, and hopefully something good comes out of it.
Again, we are Tin Shed and Savage. It's Tin Shed Tavern and Pizza. You can find out more information about their joint at tinshedmn.com. You see Michael Russo's beautiful face on their website. They also have a lot of deals. They have coupons on their deals page. They also describe all their deals: 2-for-1 happy hour, $5 happy hour drinks, $5 happy hour appetizers, 2-for-1 all day, every day. They have kids deals. So check out tinshedmn.com. Go to the deals tab, or you can check out their menu, their groups, and the games. We're in the big kind of party room here, and they have video games and all kinds of fun stuff. It's always a good time coming out here. Also want to thank our primary sponsor, Twill, in the Dining Galleria. Scott Dayton is having an event tomorrow. They have a ton of these events. They will kind of have one of their primary clothiers come in and show off their best stuff. They'll offer some deals. It's in the Dining Gallery. It's really easy in and out. Really nice people. And I highly recommend it. I just went there and bought some stuff for the fall. I'm going to go back tomorrow and buy some more stuff at the Hickey Freeman Show. TwillMN.com.
I'm here with my wife, Stacy. We went to Twill in the Dining Gallery the other day. We saw Scott Dayton, and I bought the nicest sport jacket I've ever owned, the most comfortable pants I've ever owned. They're Bracks. A nice pair of loafers that I can wear to the ballpark. I think they're called Tracks. And I bought a bunch of Stenstrom short sleeve shirts to go with my Stenstrom nice dress shirts. And, you know, I used to wear just disposable clothes. Now when I buy something, I buy it at Twill. I know it's going to last me the rest of my life, and it's going to be comfortable.
And on top of that, it's not just the best stuff you've ever had, but it's really everyday things that you can wear and that will fit all occasions.
Twill in the Dining Galleria, twillmn.com, Twill on Instagram.
So tell me about the Spurgeon contract.
$53.025 million over 7 years. Hefty. I think it was the last podcast or the podcast before I said that I thought his contract would go 7.5. And it did. It's 7.5 pretty much on the dot. In fact, he gets about $35,000 more than Parisian Suter. So he now is the largest cap hit in Wild history. Look... they could have played a little more hardball, tried to convince him to take a little less. But the second that Trouba signed for $8 million, the Wild were screwed. That's what happens when you wait. You know, to me, waiting never makes sense. Because if you wait, usually you're either going to want to get rid of the guy or you're going to have to overpay him. And they you know, Bill Guerin paid for to me some mistakes by the old regime by just not being at all aggressive with this. I still don't understand how it's humanly possible that they, knowing from April on that they needed to get in front of this, had one conversation with them, and that was at the June draft, and then nothing in between the time at the June draft that it reported in Vancouver and the time that Paul Fenton was fired on July 29th or 30th. And so you could have probably said, look, you know, take 6-8, take 6-9, take 7, whatever, you know, help us maybe, you know, keep the cap hit a little lower here, maybe even go 8 years to get the cap number down and get 90% of that salary into your pocket, even if you don't play that last year. But I don't think that Bill Guerin wanted his first move with the Wild fighting over such an important player to this team and good citizen on this team. So, and I do think that, look, as much as Jared Spurgeon says, hey, I never was thinking about free agency and I was willing, you know, I always wanted to stay here and didn't think the grass is greener elsewhere. The reality is he was willing to walk. And that was an absolute truth is that, you know, he was willing to go to free agency. And so they knew that. They didn't want Bill Guerin, also with his history and having a couple of contract disputes himself, he didn't want to go into the season with Jared having this on his mind. So he gets in front of it, and Jared becomes the first of the pending unrestricted free agents to resign. Now, all of a sudden, I thought it was funny. I don't know if you guys, if everybody noticed, but Tory Krug liked the tweet of my story, and I bet I know why, because market price for him. Petrangelo, Yossi, Brody, Barry. There's just a lot of group threes. I think we're very happy with that Jared Spurgeon contract.
So Jared is, I'm looking up his age now, he is 29 years old. Is he absolutely at his peak? Is he a finished product, or is there a way either he could improve or the team could use him better? Is there any more upside left here?
Well, I think the team could use him better, but I do think that he has a lot more upside still left in him. The thing is that now he's going to be back on a second power play. Now he's going to be back in the second unit. So I think points-wise, if people think that he's going to suddenly become Drew Doughty or Brent Burns, I mean, or Matt Dumba even, it's just not going to happen. He's going to settle into his role, get back into his shutdown role with Jonas Brodin, and is a real good insurance policy if all of a sudden Bruce doesn't like the way that Dumba and Suter look or Dumba gets hurt again. But I still think that he is not somebody that's going to get old quickly. He is turning 30 this year. That's a little dangerous, obviously, when you give seven-year deals to somebody that next year when his contract starts, he's going to be 30, turning 31. But I just don't see that somebody like this is going to suddenly fall off the map or become, you know, a Danny Heatley or somebody like that maybe there, or Thomas Vanek, where skating becomes a bit of an issue later in a career. That usually happens to bigger guys. Jared just doesn't look to me like somebody that's just going to all of a sudden become old quick.
And what allows him to survive and to play well at his size?
Well, he's brilliant, first of all. I mean, he's just a smart, smart hockey player. It is uncanny the amount of times he goes into the corner and comes away the puck. And it's all body position. It's all history of always being a small guy and having to adjust to always in every single level play against bigger guys. And I just think it's smart. So I remember when the Wild gave him, I think it was a 3-year deal, a 275. It would have been probably 6 years ago or 7 years ago at this point. I remember talking to Chuck Fletcher on the phone. I'm like, what are you doing? I said that to him. He goes, what? And I'm like, what are you giving Jared Spurgeon 275 for? And he goes, Mike, I'm telling you, this guy is going to be a great player. He goes, by the end of this contract, he is going to hit a home run. And he did. By the end of that contract, 4-year deal at 5.187. You know, by the end of this guy's career here, he's probably going to play more games in a Wild uniform than Mikko Koivu. It's pretty unbelievable.
Man, how's Mikko doing?
Mikko right now looks really good these scrimmages. He doesn't show any signs of the injury last year. What's really interesting, and we'll see it in tonight's game, this will obviously be outdated when this comes out, but we'll see how Eriksson Ek does on a line with Kunin and Greenway, because Eriksson Ek wants that spot. And if he gets that spot, well, then Mikko very well could start the season as a fourth-line center, which will be interesting. And that's been a lot of Mikko Koivu's critics have wanted that for, you know, the last couple of years. So he'll have to be mature about it if that's the case. But we'll see. But right now, he doesn't look like he's got any real concern about his knee. He says that it's still sort of in the back of his mind, but when you watch him go and skate in the corner in high traffic areas, he doesn't seem to me to be like Luke Cunningham last year. I remember when he first got up after going his stint in Iowa, you could still see it was sort of in his head. And right now it's, you know, it seems like Miko's kind of going to overcome this, at least from the mental standpoint.
We,